Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy for the date 13th of September 2019. Displayed are the list of news articles taken up for today's analysis, along with the page numbers of Chennai, Bengaluru, Delhi and Trivandrum editions. The handwritten notes in PDF format and the timestamping of all the news articles taken up for today's analysis is available in the description section and also in the comment section for the benefit of the smartphone users. Let us now start our discussion. This news article is about Pradhan Mantri Kisan Mandhan Yojana, then Pradhan Mantri Laghu Vyapari Mandhan Yojana, then about the first paperless legislative assembly in India. Then it also speaks about a river and multimodal cargo terminal, and finally it talks about Eklavya Model Residential School. So we shall be seeing all this in our news article analysis now. The syllabus that is relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. Just have a look at it. First, let us briefly see the pension schemes launched by the Prime Minister yesterday. Two pension schemes were launched yesterday. One pension scheme is the Social Security scheme, which is for the farmers. This scheme is called as Pradhan Mantri Kisan Mandhan Yojana. The government sources say that this is the first ever pension scheme for the farmers. Another pension scheme is for the Laghu Vyaparis or the small traders. They are self-employed. So this scheme is called as Pradhan Mantri Laghu Vyapari Mandhan Yojana. See, though the notification came for this scheme on 22nd July 2019, this scheme was officially launched yesterday only by the Prime Minister. The name Laghu Vyapari means that the scheme is applicable to the small traders. These schemes are social security schemes that will be helpful to the beneficiaries for their social security when they attain 60 years of age. Know that in both the schemes, certain provisions are common. Say for example, the assured minimum monthly pension. It is 3000 rupees after attaining the age of 60 years for both the schemes. And also in both the schemes, the age category for the eligibility is also same. That is, they shall not be lesser than 18 years of age and they shall also not exceed 40 years of age. That means a person whose age is say 17 or 41 is not eligible under both these schemes. And once they have joined the scheme, their monthly contribution for pension will vary depending on their age. That is, say if a person joins after attaining 18 years of age, he will be contributing 55 rupees per month. And the government will also contribute 55 rupees per month for him. Say if a person is joining at the age of 40, which is the upper limit, then that beneficiary has to contribute rupees 200 per month, and the government will also contribute an equal amount of 200 rupees per month for him or her. So as the age goes up, the contribution by the pensioner will also go up. See, this contribution that is made by the government for the beneficiaries so as to give financial assistance in their old age can be considered as a part of Article 41 of Indian Constitution. So Article 41 comes under Part 4 of Indian Constitution, which is nothing but the directive principles of state policy. And specifically, this Article 41 of Indian Constitution states that the state shall, within the limits of its economic capacity and development, shall make effective provision for public assistance in case of old age. So it is a moral obligation of the state to provide public assistance in case of old age. So it is up to the state to enact laws for the welfare of the old age people. So this pension scheme can be considered under this Article 41 of Indian Constitution. So for both the schemes, once the beneficiary attains the superannuation age, that is 60 years for both the schemes, they will receive an assured minimum monthly pension of rupees 3000. Here, superannuation age means the age up to which both the beneficiary and the government will contribute for the future pension benefits. That is, if a beneficiary is 18 years old, then till 60 years, she will be contributing monthly amount of rupees 55. And after 60 years, she will be receiving rupees 3000 minimum assured pension per month. Now, let us come to the main difference of the schemes. We saw that one scheme is for the farmers, which is called as Pradhan Mantri Kisan Mandhan Yojana. Here, Kisan means farmer. So who are the farmers who are eligible for the pension benefits under this scheme? Those farmers who own 2 hectares or less than 2 hectares of land is eligible for this scheme. See, this is the definition for small and marginal farmers. farmers with land holding of up to 1 hectare are called as marginal farmers, and farmers with a land holding of more than 1 hectare and up to 2 hectares are called as small farmers. Regarding landless tenant farmers, we do not know what kind of benefits that they will receive under this scheme. Now, let us come to Pradhan Mantri Laghu Vyapari Mandan Yojana. So, who are these small traders and what are the most important conditions of eligibility? To qualify as Laghu Vyapari, first they have to be self-employed and they should be working as small traders like shop owners or as retail traders, such as rice mill owners, oil mill owners, then workshop owners, then commission agents. Then they could also be brokers of real estate, then owners of small hotels, small restaurants and other laghu vyaparis. So all this is as per the government notification and all these people will be eligible under this scheme. The second most important criteria that define the self-employed small trader is that their annual turnover must not exceed rupees 1.5 crores. And this is to be based on the self-declaration by the laghu vyaparis. One more mandatory thing is that they should be having a savings bank account in his or her name and also the Aadhaar details. That is, they should have an Aadhaar number. One fact to note here is that as of now, there is no mention about street vendors who may not own a shop. So we are not sure about this category of laghu vyaparis. And know that the scheme is also called as a pension for self-employed entrepreneurs. So we will be seeing more developments in our future analysis as and when these schemes are reported in the newspaper. Next, there was a mention in the news article that the first paperless legislative assembly of India was inaugurated by the Prime Minister. So Prime Minister inaugurated the first paperless legislative assembly of India in Jharkhand. So this is the Jharkhand Assembly building. The other special feature of this building is that it has also taken some steps towards protecting the environment. We are saying this because the building will run on solar energy and it will also have water harvesting and energy conservation structures. So this is one small snippet. Next, let us see about India's second riverine multimodal terminal. This is also mentioned in the news article. This terminal was inaugurated by Prime Minister yesterday at Sahibganj in Jharkhand. So we saw that this is India's second riverine multimodal terminal. Where is the first riverine multimodal terminal located? It is built in Varanasi and this terminal was inaugurated by Prime Minister in November 2018. Know that both these terminals were built as a part of developing National Waterway 1 under Jal Marg Vikas project. This project is being done with the assistance from the World Bank. And when we tell National Waterway 1, it refers to the Haldia Prayagraj or Haldia Allahabad stretch of the river Ganga. And the length of this waterway is around 1620 kilometers. Under this Jal Marg Vikas project, multimodal terminals with rail and road connectivity are to be constructed at three locations. They are Varanasi in the state of Uttar Pradesh, Haldia in the state of West Bengal, and Sahibganj in the state of Jharkhand. And all these terminals are on the banks of River Ganga. So know this fact. And as of now, only two terminals have been constructed and inaugurated, which are the terminals at Varanasi in Uttar Pradesh and Sahibganj in the state of Jharkhand. Once the work at Haldia and West Bengal is over, it may become the third riverine multimodal terminal in India. Now, this second terminal, which was inaugurated at Sahibganj in Jharkhand, will specially benefit the coal industries, then the stone chips industries, then the fertilizer industries, and also the cement and sugar industries. It will act as a converging point for the road, rail, and river routes. Therefore, it will improve the multimodal connectivity to Kolkata, Haldia, and the adjoining areas. Another special feature of this terminal is that it will be connected to the northeastern states through a foreign territory. Here the foreign territory is the country of Bangladesh. This will be done by a river sea route through Bangladesh. Now let us see the capacity of this terminal that was built at Sahibganj. The present capacity is 30 lakh tons per annum. The government has set the target of achieving 54.8 lakh tons per annum in the future in this terminal. So this is all about India's second riverine multimodal terminal. Next, let us see about Eklavya Modern Residential Schools. This has also been mentioned in the newspaper. Know that Eklavya Model Residential Schools come under the Ministry of Tribal Affairs of the Government of India. The news article, it states that the Prime Minister has laid the foundation stone online for around 462 Eklavya model schools across India. See, these schools were started in the year 1997-1998. The purpose of these schools is to impart quality education to children belonging to the scheduled tribes who are located in the remote areas, so that these children in the future will be able to avail opportunities in high and professional educational courses. So it is to ensure that those children who are from the scheduled tribes will also have the best opportunities in education at par with the non-scheduled tribe population, that is rest of the population, and also to ensure that they'll be getting employment in various sectors once they get educated. See, these schools will focus not only on the academic education but also on the all-round development of those students from the scheduled tribes. Each Eklavya school has a capacity of 480 students, and these schools will cater to the students from class 6 to class 12. This means these schools cater to the middle school classes and high school education and also higher secondary school education. And in these schools, the education will be entirely free. So the entire funding for these schools will be received as grant in aid from the central government. So the state governments and the union territories are responsible for the management and effective functioning of these model residential schools, and they will receive funds for running these schools from the central government, and this funding is made available under Article 275 Clause 1 of the Constitution of India. So this news article talks about 462 new schools. As per the union budget, which was presented for the financial year 2018-2019, that is the previous year union budget, every block that has more than 50% population belonging to the scheduled tribes, and if the block has at least 20,000 tribal persons, then this block will have an Eklavya model residential school by the year 2022. So this was the plan as per the union budget of 2018-2019. As per this, the government has set a target to complete 462 new Eklavya schools by the year 2022, that is by the 75th year of Indian independence. So this is all about Eklavya model residential schools. So from this one news article, we have seen some social sector schemes like Pradhan Mantri Kisan Mahandan Yojana, then Pradhan Mantri Laghu Vyapari Mahandan Yojana, then about the first paperless legislative assembly in the country, which was inaugurated in the state of Jharkhand, then about the second riverine multi-model cargo terminal, which has come up at Sahibganj, the state of Jharkhand, and also we have seen about Eklavya model residential schools. Let us move on to the next news article. This news article is about dengue. The school education department of the state of Tamil Nadu has issued guidelines to all the educational institutions in the state to create awareness of dengue and take steps to prevent the spread of the viral fever during the rainy season. The syllabus relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. Let us now see the news article. The main theme of this news article is about the dengue fever. The rainy season is going to start, so the school education department has issued guidelines to all the institutions across the state in order to create some awareness over this dengue fever. And the institutions are bound to take some necessary steps in order to prevent the spread of this fever. So let us see about dengue fever. Dengue is a mosquito-borne viral infection. So this is a viral infection which is caused by a virus which belongs to the genus Flavivirus, and this genus belongs to the family Flaviviridae. So within this genus, the dengue virus comprises of four different serotypes, which are DEN1, DEN2, DEN3 and DEN4. So just know that there are four different types of virus belonging to the genus Flavivirus. And we saw that dengue is a mosquito-borne viral infection. Mosquito-borne means the infection is being transmitted by the mosquito. So mosquito acts as a carrier or a transmitter, or we can tell that mosquito acts as a vector. During our 10th September analysis, we saw in detail about what is meant by a vector-borne disease, that is those infectious diseases which is being transmitted by a vector, where vector is a living organism. Mostly it can be different types of insects, and we saw that mosquito is a major insect which acts as a vector, and there were three different types of mosquitoes which we saw, out of which Aedes type of mosquito is one. So dengue is being transmitted by Aedes aegypti mosquito. So remember this. Once the Aedes aegypti mosquito bites a human being for having its blood meal, the viruses are passed on to humans. And once the humans are infected, they act as main carriers or the multipliers of the virus. And once the infected person is bitten by one or more mosquitoes, those mosquitoes will get infected. And when they go for having blood meal from some other persons, then they'll transmit the mosquitoes to the other persons as well. So more persons will be infected, and they will also act as carriers of this virus. So this is how dengue spreads from humans to humans, where the Aedes aegypti mosquito acts as a vector. This dengue fever occurs in two forms. One is the classical dengue fever, which is also called as breakbone fever. And the next type of dengue fever is the dengue hemorrhagic fever. This dengue hemorrhagic fever is a severe dengue fever, which can even lead to death. Dengue usually occurs in tropical and subtropical regions of the world. And this disease is endemic in more than 100 countries. And it is spread across continents, in the continents of Africa, in the Americas, then in the Eastern Mediterranean, then in Southeast Asia, and also in the Western Pacific region. In India also, this disease is quite common. It occurs in almost all the states. This dengue fever affects all kinds of population, starting from infants, children, and even the adults are affected by dengue fever. If this fever is not treated properly, it could be fatal. That is, there are high chances that the individual is likely to die. Now let us see some of the common symptoms that can occur in an individual if he or she is affected by dengue fever. Usually the individual will have a very high fever, and it will be accompanied by the following symptoms like muscle and joint pains, then severe headache, then pain behind the eyes, then they'll have a vomiting sensation, they'll also have nausea, and some people also develop rashes. So once the mosquito bites, the virus will incubate, or it will grow for a period of 4 to 10 days within the human body, and the symptoms usually last for 2 to 7 days after this incubation period. So a proper medical treatment needs to be given. If you see, there is no specific treatment for dengue fever. Usually patients should seek medical advice, then they should take a lot of rest, and they should drink plenty of fluids. It can be water or juice. Generally, paracetamol tablet is given. So this will bring down the fever, and it will also reduce the joint pains. The World Health Organization tells that aspirin or ibuprofen should not be taken when a person is having dengue fever, because they can increase the risk of bleeding. Now let us see some of the preventive measures to tackle this dengue fever. We saw that dengue is also a vector-borne disease, that is, a mosquito-borne viral disease. So the prevention actually focuses on eradicating or eliminating the mosquitoes. So all the preventive measures are focused towards that. Some of the preventive measures are given here, like insect repellents and usage of mosquito nets. Then the persons are advised to wear long sleeve clothes and also long trousers so that they will not be affected by mosquito bites. We saw that dengue occurs in tropical and subtropical regions, especially in those regions where there is improper infrastructure, for example, like the urban slums. So a proper solid waste disposal system needs to be there in those places. If there is proper solid waste disposal, then breeding of mosquitoes can be avoided. And also there should be proper water storage practices, because open containers with water will act as a breeding ground for the mosquitoes. So there should be improved water storage practices. Then even pesticide spraying or fogging is an effective measure to prevent the growth of the mosquitoes. So fog means dense mist-like conditions. It is a thick cloud of tiny water droplets which is suspended in the atmosphere. So usually during the winter seasons we can see fogging. Similar to that is the fogging process. So artificially, fog is created by blasting the mixture of insecticide and water into very fine water droplets through the fogging machine. So this is one such preventive measure to prevent the growth of the mosquitoes. So we can see that all the preventive measures are focused towards preventing the growth of the mosquitoes. Next, let us see about vaccination. As of now, there is no vaccine which has been approved by the World Health Organization. There is one vaccine which is in the development stage, which is called as Dengvaxia. It has been developed by a company called Sanofi Pasteur, and this vaccine has been approved for use in certain countries. But as of now, this vaccine has not been approved by the World Health Organization, and this vaccine is also not approved in India. So know that there is a vaccine which is in the development stage. So this is all about the dengue fever that you need to know from exam point of view. Now let us come back to the news article. We saw that since dengue is a vector-borne disease, all preventive measures should be taken towards preventing the growth of the mosquitoes. So even in the guidelines, you can see that, which is mentioned in the news article, like the director of school education has asked the school heads to ensure that the entire campuses, classrooms, bathrooms are all kept clean. And they have to ensure that there is no water stagnation, because if there is water stagnation, it will act as a breeding ground for the mosquitoes. Apart from this, the guidelines has also asked the schools to create awareness about dengue among the students by discussing with the students during the morning assembly, and also by putting up banners and posters on campus, and also through the student clubs and associations such as NSS, NCC, Scouts and Guides, etc. So in this news article, we have mainly seen about dengue, what causes dengue, about the symptoms of dengue, the treatment, preventive measures, vaccination, and about the guidelines issued by the State Education Department. Now have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. This news article is regarding the Motor Vehicles Amendment Act of 2019, and it also discusses about the concurrent list. The syllabus relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. Now let us see the news article. We know that recently the Motor Vehicles Amendment Act of 2019 was passed in the parliament. So whenever any amendment to a principal act, it is introduced as a bill and it is passed by both the houses of the parliament. Then once it receives the president's assent, it becomes an act. So likewise, the Motor Vehicles Amendment Bill of 2019 was introduced in the parliament. It was passed in the parliament, in both the houses of the parliament. Then it received the president assent, and then it has become the Motor Vehicles Amendment Act of 2019. So this amendment act has amended certain provisions of the principal act. The principal act is Motor Vehicles Act of 1988. Now the issue that is revolving around this act is that huge fines have been introduced for majority of the road traffic violations. This news tells that Gujarat has reduced certain traffic fines. Gujarat has imposed fines below the lower limits that has been prescribed under the Motor Vehicles Act. For example, in the recently amended act, if an individual is not wearing any seat belt, then they can be imposed ₹1,000 as a penalty. But the Gujarat government has imposed only a fine of 500, that is only ₹500 as penalty for not wearing a seat belt. So we can see that Gujarat government has reduced the fine amount. The second issue, similarly, if you see, as per the recent amendment act, if the pillion rider, that is those persons who are riding the vehicle, if they are not wearing a helmet, then they have to pay a fine of ₹1,000, and also their license will be disqualified for a period of 3 months. These actions are also same for those people who are violating one more rule, which is if there is more than one pillion rider in a vehicle. Now, don't focus on all these fine amounts and limits. The main thing that you need to know is that road transport comes under concurrent list. Now, let us focus on this concurrent list. See, Article 246 of Indian Constitution discusses about the subject matter of laws that are made by the parliament, and also laws that are made by the legislature of the states. Under this Article 246, concurrent list has been discussed. So clause 2 of Article 246 tells that both the parliament and the legislature of any state have the power to make laws with respect to any of the matters that are enumerated, that is, that are mentioned in list 3 in the 7th schedule. The 7th schedule of Indian Constitution discusses about the union list, state list and the concurrent list. List 3 is the concurrent list. So in whatever matters that are mentioned under this concurrent list, both the parliament and the legislature of any state have the power to make laws. So remember this. But what if there is any inconsistency between the laws that are made by the parliament and the laws that are made by the legislature of any state on a particular subject? For that, we have Article 254 in Indian Constitution. Now, this Article 254 discusses about the inconsistency between the laws made by the Parliament and the laws made by the legislature of the state. Here, inconsistency means any contradiction. So, the news that we are seeing is a classic example of the contradiction, because the central government has given some fine limits for certain violations, but the state government of Gujarat has imposed fines below the actual limit that has been imposed by the central government. So, we can see that there is an inconsistency between the laws that have been made by the parliament and the laws that have been made by the legislature of the state. Article 254 tells that whenever such inconsistency arises, then the law made by the parliament will prevail. So, here the state governments will not have any say. But in certain conditions, state governments will have a say. That is, those laws that are made by the state legislature will prevail. So, what is the condition for that? Those laws that have been reserved for the consideration of the president, and once the president gives his assent to those laws, then only such laws of the state legislature will prevail over the laws that have been made by the parliament. So, president assent is must for the state law to prevail. So, remember, Article 254 discusses about the inconsistency between the laws made by the parliament and the laws made by the legislature of the state. This news article tells that the Ministry of Road Transport and Highways has sought the opinion of the Ministry of Law and Justice on whether the state governments can actually change the lower limit for the fines which are prescribed in the Motor Vehicles Amendment Act of 2019 after this Gujarat incident, because we saw that Gujarat has reduced some of the fines mentioned under this act. So, from this news article, know that Article 246 discusses about Schedule 7 and Article 254 discusses about the inconsistency in the laws that are made under the concurrent list. And also know that road transport comes under concurrent list. To be specific, it is mentioned in item number 35, which discusses about mechanically propelled vehicles, including the principles on which the taxes on such vehicles are to be levied. So, based on this item 35, we are telling that this act will come under concurrent list. Now, have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. This editorial is also about the Motor Vehicles Amendment Act. In this editorial, the author is insisting on better enforcement and better road infrastructure so that road safety will be ensured, because recently the general public is angered over the higher road fines that has been imposed under the recent Motor Vehicles Amendment Act of 2019. The syllabus relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. Now, let us see the editorial. We saw that the Motor Vehicle Amendment Act amends the principal act, which is the Motor Vehicles Act of 1988. This new act has made several changes to the original act. The very important thing to note in this act is the huge increase in the fines and penalties for violating certain provisions of the act. We also saw in our previous news article that Gujarat government has reduced fines for certain sections, because the huge penalties for violating the road rules has produced a strong negative reaction among the common people, that is the general public. So, several state governments have decided to reduce the quantum of the fines or even to reject certain new provisions. The author has also mentioned certain state governments, like Gujarat has announced a substantial reduction in fines, which we also saw. Then the government of West Bengal has refused to adopt the higher penalties. And also the state governments of Karnataka and Kerala are studying the possibilities to make the provisions less stringent, that is to make it some more flexible. So, we can see that many states are viewing this amendment act with a certain caution. The author is telling that the motorists, that is those people who ride the vehicles, are against the higher fines that has been imposed by their respective state governments, because they are telling that there is no point in enforcing stricter rules without upgrading the road infrastructure and without addressing certain administrative issues. Like, for example, getting proper transport documents is quite a difficult process. So, the motorists are feeling that there is no point in enforcing rules without focusing on all these. The author also tells that the union minister has told to the states that it is up to the states to choose the quantum of their fines, because the union minister has told that it is the responsibility of the state governments to enforce strict adherence to the laws so that they don't violate the laws. And it is also the responsibility of the state governments to protect the lives of the citizens. Here, the author has mentioned one statistics. He has told that in the year of 2017, almost 147,913 people died in road accidents. So even the author believes that if only increasing the fines will help in reducing the road accidents without addressing other issues, like for example, the administrative reforms, also the infrastructure. So in the second part of the editorial, the author has given some suggestions in order to improve the road safety and also to further strengthen the objective of the recently amended Motor Vehicles Act. So two suggestions are regarding the recent amendments made to the Motor Vehicles Act of 1988. First, let us see section 198A mentioned by the author. The author feels that the core of the reforms made to this act is this section 198A. Now, this section tells that it is the duty of the designated authority, designated contractor, consultant or concessionaire who is responsible for the design or construction or the maintenance of the safety standards of the road to follow the standards which are prescribed by the central government. So it is the duty of those people or those personnels who are associated with constructing the road infrastructure, and it is also the duty of those personnels who are associated with maintaining the particular road infrastructure to follow the standards that are prescribed by the central government. Now, if these people are not following the standards, then they are liable for penalty because they are also a reason for the death or disability that happens due to the road accidents. Here, to this section, the author has given very general comment that the road users in all the states should enforce this particular section through litigation. Here he means to tell that the general public should come forward and enforce this particular section through legal means. The next section discussed by the author is the section 215B, which has been introduced in this Motor Vehicles Amendment Act of 2019. This section 215B enables the central government to constitute a national road safety board. So this road safety board will advise the central and the state governments on matters related to road safety and traffic management, like the standards of the design, then the weight, construction, manufacturing process, operation, and the maintenance of the motor vehicles. Then it will also lay down standards for the road safety, road infrastructure, and control of traffic. Then it will also manage the programs for educating and sensitizing the drivers and other road users. So the author is urging the central government to immediately constitute the National Road Safety Board. And the author also tells that this National Road Safety Board should recommend important changes to the road infrastructure, and it should also enable professional accident investigation. If you see this, professional accident investigation is very much common in the Western nations. For example, in the country of United Kingdom. So whenever any accident happens, immediately an investigation will be carried out. So the entire and the accurate data of the incident will be gathered, and the root cause of that particular accident will be analyzed. That is, the root cause of that particular incident will be analyzed, and they'll be suggesting certain control measures so that that particular accident will not repeat in the future. So the author is telling that the new National Road Safety Board should also work towards enabling professional accident investigation. So we can see that both these sections are directly or indirectly related to improving the road infrastructure. So the author is suggesting that the road infrastructure should meet the legal requirements. So this is his third suggestion. If the road infrastructure is not proper, then it will be easily challenged in the court of law. Because if the governments are going to impose huge fines, and if they try to enforce the law, then it can easily be challenged in the court on the pretext that the road infrastructure is very poor. And when we tell road infrastructure, it includes the condition of roads, traffic signals, the signage, that is the signs that are kept on the roads, then the cautionary markings on the roads. All these come under the road infrastructure. So the author is telling that the road infrastructure should meet the legal requirement. So we saw that this act comes under the concurrent list, and state governments also have an equal role to play under this act. So the author is telling that the state governments have the responsibility to reform their regional transport authorities, because these regional transport offices are generally steeped in corruption. That is, still corruption happens in all these offices. Then the author has also told that the Ministry of Road Transport and Highways should have made the electronic delivery of the RTO services as a mandatory one, because in the previous UPA government a bill was introduced, and in that they suggested to make the electronic delivery of the RTO services a mandatory one. But right now it is not mandatory. So the author is telling that the present government should work on this. So this is one more suggestion which has been given by the author. Finally, the author has discussed about the behavioral aspect. Here he has mentioned a phrase which is culture of impunity. Now a culture of impunity means not getting punished for violating the rules. If you see in the Indian scenario, especially the government vehicles and the VIPs ignore the road rules and they don't get punished for violating the rules. Because of this, the general public is also not following the road rules properly. So if this culture of impunity is ended, the author expects that the general public or the average citizen will follow the road rules. So we can see that author has given varied suggestions, like proper implementation of the Motor Vehicles Amendment Act of 2019. Then he has also pushed the state governments to play their role in ensuring road safety. And he has also spoken about the behavioral aspect of how the culture of impunity must be ended. So the ultimate takeaway from this article is that just imposing higher fines will not ensure the enforceability of the rules. But the road infrastructure requires improvement, and there must also be administrative reforms so that road safety is ensured on the whole. Now have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. This news article states that the Supreme Court has continued the stay on the eviction of the forest dwellers. The syllabus relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. The title of the news article states that the stay continues on the eviction of forest dwellers. That is, the stay order issued by the Supreme Court on the eviction of forest dwellers will continue. With respect to forest dwellers, we have a legislation which is called as the Scheduled Tribes and Other Traditional Forest Dwellers Recognition of Forest Rights Act of 2006. In short, it is called as the Forest Rights Act of 2006. This act came into force in December 2006. The purpose of this act was to recognize and vest the forest rights and occupation in forest land. So to whom these rights and occupation of forest lands are to be accorded, these rights and forest occupation are to be vested in forest dwellers who are belonging to scheduled tribes and other traditional forest dwellers. They are called forest dwellers because they have been residing in such forests for generations, but their rights could not be recorded. This act also provided for a framework for recording the forest rights vested with forest dwellers and the nature of evidence required for such recognition and vesting in respect of forest land. So how, even after such a legislation, forest dwellers can be evicted? We should know that on 13th of February 2019, there was an order by the Supreme Court to evict those people who were claiming as forest dwelling scheduled tribes and other traditional forest dwellers if their claims are rejected under the Forest Rights Act of 2006. That is, if their claims are rejected, they have to be evicted. The Supreme Court's order had the directions to around 16 states. The chief secretaries of these 16 states were asked to evict the rejected claimants, and this has to be ensured before 24th of July 2019. Overall, over many states, the total number of persons whose claims were rejected were approximately around 11.9 lakhs. Many civil society organizations that work on forest rights claim that many of the persons who are rejected are actually genuine traditional forest dwellers. There was a huge uproar and discussion which happened nationwide about this Supreme Court's order to evict the persons whose claims were rejected. According to this news article, the central government moved the Supreme Court to modify the 13th February order. So on 28th of February 2019, the Supreme Court stayed the previous order that asked to carry out the eviction. So the present news is that this stay order that was issued on 13th of February will continue, and by 26th of November, this matter will again be taken in Supreme Court. This means that this matter will be in news by the last week of November again. Now, let us see how the claims are filed and who is the final authority over this matter. Section 6 of the Forest Rights Act of 2006 talks about the authorities to vest forest rights in forest-dwelling scheduled tribes and other traditional forest dwellers. The Gram Sabha is the authority which is responsible to receive the claims, and it is also the authority to determine the nature and extent of an individual's claim. So, a resolution will be passed by the Gram Sabha on the claim made. Now, will this resolution of Gram Sabha be considered as final? No. This is because there is another committee which is called as Subdivisional Level Committee. This committee will examine the resolution passed by the Gram Sabha, and this committee will also prepare the record of the forest rights. And whether the record of the forest rights that is being prepared by this Subdivisional Committee, the final one, again it's a no. This is because there is one another committee which is called as District Level Committee. The job of this District Level Committee is to consider the record of forest rights that are prepared by the Subdivisional Level Committee, and this District Level Committee has to finally approve the record of forest rights that is prepared by the Subdivisional Level Committee. The record of rights approved by this District Level Committee is final and binding. So know that District Level Committee decision is final and binding. This is one part. If a person is aggrieved or not satisfied with the resolution of Gram Sabha, then he or she may prefer a petition to the Subdivisional Level Committee. And such a petition has to be filed within 60 days from the date of passing of the resolution by the Gram Sabha. And if a person is aggrieved by the decision of Subdivisional Level Committee, then the person can prefer a petition to the District Level Committee. And such a petition to the District Level Committee has to be made within 60 days from the date of decision of the Subdivisional Level Committee. So, whatever the case, the decision of the District Level Committee is final and binding on the claimants. See, whatever we saw involves legal procedures, and it requires legal awareness and legal literacy among the forest dwellers. Now, one more angle is there in the definition of the other traditional forest dwellers. Say, for example, there are certain tribal communities who are not recognized as scheduled tribes, but they may be living in forests for several years, and they are called as other traditional forest dwellers. If we look at the legal definition in the Act for other traditional forest dwellers, it means any member or any community who for at least three generations prior to 13th December 2005 has primarily resided in the forest and who depend on the forest or forest land for bona fide livelihood needs. Such generation criteria are not there for forest dwelling scheduled tribes other than the cutoff date of 13th December 2005. For a real forest dweller, proving his primary residence in the forest for at least three generations before 13th of December 2005 may be difficult because of the lack of documents, lack of education, lack of knowledge of the storing of documents, etc. And anyway, if the forest dwellers lack legal literacy, whatever mentioned in the law, they may not file petitions before the Subdivisional Level Committee or the District Level Committee. And many forest dwellers may not be even knowing who is the final authority in this matter. As a result, as per many reports, the claims of many genuine forest dwellers are rejected. So, the stay of the Supreme Court means temporary relief for such genuine forest dwellers. Meanwhile, the bigger industrial giants want some other thing, that is, those persons whose claims are rejected have to be immediately evicted from the forests so that they can set up resorts or other illegal structures in the forest land. The Supreme Court has stated that such encroachments for resorts and illegal structures are the encroachments on the forest, and it leads to depletion of green cover of the nation. This news article also mentions that there shall be much focus on the lakhs of forest dwellers who face eviction if unless remedial steps are made. So, for more information on this matter, we have to wait till 26th of November 2019. Now, have a look at the practice question. Next, let us see about Mohiniyattam, which is one of the classical dance forms of India. The syllabus that is relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. There is a picture in the Trivandrum edition which shows the performance of Mohiniyattam by an artist as a part of Onam celebrations. Now let us see about Mohiniyattam. Mohiniyattam is interpreted as the dance of Mohini. In Hindu mythology, there is a Puranic story which tells that Lord Vishnu transformed himself to a Mohini in order to seduce the Asuras. So Mohiniyattam is interpreted as the dance of Mohini. And know that this is the classical solo dance form of the state of Kerala. See, this dance form is ideally suited for the performance by women because of its delicate body movements and subtle facial expressions. Mohiniyattam has been mentioned in literatures. The reference of Mohiniyattam can be found in a literature called as Vyavaharamala, which was written in the year 1709. It was written by Malamagalam Narayanan Nambudiri, and the reference of Mohiniyattam is also found in Goshayatra, which has been written by Kunjan Nambiar. So just know that Mohiniyattam has been found in the earlier literature. This dance form has been structured into the present day classical format by the kings of Travancore. There are two kings who played a major role. One is Maharaja Kartika Thirunal, and the next king is his successor Maharaja Swati Thirunal. This dance form traces its origin to the temples of Kerala. So the dances were called by different names during different periods of time. There are women folks who are called as Nangiyars. They still follow a strict code of dance. They perform in a small performing space within the temple premises as it was practiced during the olden days. Now let us see the silent features of Mohiniyattam dance. Mohiniyattam is characterized by a graceful swaying body movement. There will not be any abrupt jerks or any sudden leaps in the dance. The dance will entirely be graceful without any sudden movements. And know that this dance form belongs to the Lasya style. This style is quite feminine and it is also very tender, that is soft and quite graceful. The movements are emphasized by the glides and the up and down movement on the toes. So you cannot see quite a fast or an abrupt footwork, rather it is very soft footwork. And more importance is given to the hand gestures and the mukhabhinaya, that is the facial expressions. The facial expressions will be quite subtle. The movements have been borrowed from Nangiyar Kootu and female folk dances such as Kaikoti Kali and Tiruvadhara Kali. Mohiniyattam lays emphasis on acting. The dancer identifies herself with the character and sentiments which are existing in the composition, that is the song. So the song itself will provide an opportunity for the facial expressions to the dancer. And the gestures and the facial expressions are closer to the natural and realistic than to the dramatic or rigidly conventional gestures or facial expressions. So natural means the gramya, and realistic means lokadharmi, and conventional is the natyadharmi. So the gestures and facial expressions are closer to the natural and realistic. So this is all you need to know from this classical dance form. Why we are seeing this classical dance form is because UPSC has asked questions on some of the classical dance forms of India. Now let us see the classical dance forms of India. There are 8 classical dances, which are Bharatanatyam dance, Kathakali, then Kathak, then Manipuri, then Odissi, Kuchipudi, Satriya dance, and finally Mohiniyattam, which we have seen. In 2013, there was a question on the Tribhanga Mutra of Odissi dance. And in the year 2014, there was a question on the dance form of Assam, the Satriya classical dance. So whenever you see some classical dance, try to know one or two features of that particular classical dance, because quite often you might be seeing one or more classical dance forms either in the news article or sometimes in the magazine supplementary. So try to know about one or two features which are quite distinct to that particular classical dance as and when you see them in the newspapers. Now have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the practice questions discussion session. The question is, consider the following statements about dengue. Two statements have been given and they have asked you to choose the incorrect statements, that is those statements which are not correct. The first statement tells that it is a mosquito-borne viral infection. This statement is correct. Dengue is a mosquito-borne viral infection. The virus belongs to the genus Flavivirus. Now come to the second statement. The second statement tells that Anopheles mosquitoes act as vectors. we saw the definition for vectors. Vectors are those living organisms that help in transmitting the infection from animal to human or from human to human. And in case of dengue, mosquitoes belonging to the Aedes genus, especially Aedes aegypti mosquitoes, act as vectors in transmitting the virus that is responsible for causing dengue. It is not the Anopheles mosquito. So this statement goes wrong. Now the question has asked you to choose the statements that are not correct. Since statement 2 is not correct, the correct answer is option B, 2 only. Now let us see the next question. The question states that Article 246 of Indian Constitution describes the subject matter of laws made by Parliament and by the legislatures of states. Under this article, Parliament and the legislature of any state have power to make laws with respect to any of the matters enumerated in List 3 in the 7th schedule. Which of the following list does List 3 refer to? Now, this is all the definition for this Article 246. Now, what we have to focus is List 3 in the 7th schedule. Know that 7th schedule deals with division of powers between the center and the states. There are three lists under this Schedule 7. List 1 is the union list, List 2 is state list, and List 3 is the concurrent list. So under concurrent list, both the parliament and the legislature of any state have power to make laws with respect to any of the matters that is mentioned or enumerated in List 3. So the correct answer here is option C, concurrent list. There is no such list called as ad hoc list. So the correct answer is option C, concurrent list. Consider the following statements with respect to the Scheduled Tribes and Other Traditional Forest Dwellers Recognition of Forest Rights Act of 2006. They have given two statements and they have asked you to choose the correct answer. Let us see the first statement. It tells that it is a legislation to consolidate the law relating to forests, the transit of forest produce, and the duty leviable on timber and other forest produce. Now read the question again. Consider the following statements with respect to the Scheduled Tribes and Other Traditional Forest Dwellers Recognition of Forest Rights Act of 2006. So this act basically speaks about the recognition of the forest rights of the forest dwelling Scheduled Tribes and other traditional forest dwellers. It does not deal with the forests or the transit of forest produce and the duty leviable on timber and other forest produce. It is actually the Indian Forest Act of 1927, which deals with forests, the transit of forest produce, etc. So the first statement goes wrong. Now let us see the second statement. The second statement tells that other traditional forest dweller means any member or community who has for several years prior to the date of coming into force of the act primarily resided in or who depend on the forest or forest land for bona fide livelihood needs. Now, this statement is also incorrect. We saw that the definition of other traditional forest dwellers is that they have to be primarily residing on forest land for at least 3 generations prior to 13th December 2005 and depending on forest for genuine or bona fide livelihood needs. And the Forest Rights Act of 2006 came into force on 29th of December 2006 with the assent of the president. So the statement is wrong, because in the statement it is mentioned that who has lived for several years prior to the date of coming into force of the act. Here you need not even remember when this act came into force. Just know the date, that is the 13th December 2005. So you'll be able to answer this statement. Now this question has asked for the correct statements. Since both the statements are wrong, the correct answer is option D, neither 1 nor 2. Moving on to the next question. The question is, with reference to Mohiniyattam dance, consider the following statements. They have given three statements and they have asked you to choose the correct statements. The first statement tells that it is a classical solo dance form of Kerala. This statement is correct. During our discussion, we saw that Mohiniyattam dance is the classical solo dance form of the state of Kerala. Now see the second statement. It tells that it is characterized by graceful swaying body movements with no abrupt jerks or sudden leaps. We saw this statement as well during our discussion that Mohiniyattam is characterized by graceful and swaying body movements and there will not be any sudden movements like sudden jerks or sudden leaps. So this statement is also correct. Now see the third statement. It tells that it is the only classical dance of India having links with Muslim culture. This statement is wrong. Know that Kathak, which is another classical dance, is the only classical dance form of India to have links with the Muslim culture. So it is not Mohiniyattam, it is Kathak. Now this question is asked for the correct statements. Since statements 1 and 2 are correct, the correct answer is option B, 1 and 2 only. Now let us see the mains question. The question is, critically analyze the recent amendments made to the Motor Vehicles Act 1988 and suggest certain measures to improve the road safety in India. So you can split this question into two and you can address this question. The first part of the question tells that critically analyze the recent amendments made to the Motor Vehicles Act of 1988. The recent amendment act is the Motor Vehicles Amendment Act of 2019. It has asked you to critically analyze, so you can analyze the positives of the amendment and also the negatives of the amendment that has been made to the principal act, which is the Motor Vehicles Act of 1988. Now, one of the major concerns across different sections of society is that the amounts of penalties that has been increased under this amendment act is quite huge or quite high. So there has been a strong negative reaction among the people. Also, several state governments are having other thoughts to reduce the fines. Like the state government of Gujarat reduced the fine. Also, state governments like the Karnataka state government and the Kerala state government are thinking to reduce the fine. And some states have also decided to reject the new provisions. But there are certain other sections which are positives, like the section 198A, which we discussed. You need not mention the section name, but you can tell that there is a section which will increase the accountability of the authority which is responsible for the design or the construction or the maintenance of the roads, so that if there is any deviation in the road infrastructure, then they will be held liable and they will be imposed fines as mentioned in the Amendment Act. And there was also one more section, which is section 215B, which mandates for constitution of National Road Safety Board. So you can give an answer like the government should adhere to both these sections. It should hold those people or the authority accountable if the road infrastructure goes poor, and the central government should also constitute the National Road Safety Board as early as possible. Now see the second part of the question. It asks us to suggest certain measures to improve the road safety in India. Now you can just give an rough amount that around 1.5 lakh people died in road accidents during the year 2017, or if you even have better statistics, you can mention here. So give an intro about the present status of road safety in India and then start with the measures. You can suggest that increasing the fines alone will not ensure that this act would be strictly followed. Rather, there is a need to develop the road infrastructure and there is also need for administrative reforms. So we saw some administrative reforms and means to develop road infrastructure during our discussion. Also, you can mention the behavioral aspect as a part of your suggestions, like ending the culture of impunity, which is being enjoyed by the government vehicles and the VIPs, where they ignore the road rules, but they are not being fined for the violation. And you can also mention certain general suggestions, like the behavior of the general public must also change. They should voluntarily start wearing helmets. They should voluntarily start following the road rules so that the road safety is also ensured from the citizens' part. Like this, you can also give some general suggestions. With this, we come to the end of the analysis of all the news articles taken up for today's discussion and also the practice questions discussion session. Do like, comment and share the video, and do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for latest videos and updates. Thank you.